This is an RBMK. This is also an RBMK. Can you spot the difference? I would have said that one is made of blocks and the other isn't, but both are. Okay, so today I'll be talking about RBMKs, what they are, how they work, and how to build one. In Minecraft. No David Hong activities here. Quick thing to mention is, I won't be covering Reason because that's just different enough to be weird to try to explain alongside this, and it's broken half the time anyway, though I haven't played in a while, so who knows. Reactors are a type of nuclear reactor design, invented sometime between the 1970s and 80s, and stood for a series of words I've given up on pronouncing because this is the sixth take. All you need to know is that it's Russian for high power channel type reactor. Let's get into the basics of this reactor design. Most nuclear reactors boil water, and they do this with fission. A uranium nucleus gets hit by a neutron and it splits. Simple, right? Wrong. Neutrons can have different speeds which affect how likely they are to split nuclei, and even different isotopes of uranium can have wildly differing chances to fission with the same neutron. What we need is an isotope with a viable fission rate and a known set of favorable neutron speeds. The issue is that while we know the isotope, uranium-235, it splits into neutrons that are very, very fast. Why is this an issue if you have neutrons? Well, if your attention span hasn't gone to the negatives and you've been listening, you'll have realized that this speed isn't what we want, as too much energy will just bounce off the nucleus and not induce fission. We can easily fix this by slowing down the neutrons with similarly sized objects like hydrogen, but hydrogen is flammable, so instead we use water. It's cheap, accessible, consists of the things we need, and can function as our coolant. Now, because the Soviets were going for the cheapest reactor possible, they also wanted to use the cheapest fuel possible, natural uranium. To make this worthless pile of barely refined metal actually do something, you need even more moderation. Now, while it would be difficult to add more water in a space that already has incompressible water, you can add graphite for that extra bit of moderation we need. Quick side tangent, using both graphite and water leads to what's known as a positive void coefficient, because water can get really hot and evaporate, which is also called voiding. This voiding would normally remove the moderator and kill the reaction. The problem is that RBMKs have graphite, which doesn't go away, and will continuously moderate even without the coolant present. Basically, neutrons are still moderated even with no water in the reactor, and this can easily lead to overheating. On to the second final subject of this segment, neutron absorption. Very simply put, the strong nuclear force allows the neutron to be absorbed into a nucleus once close enough, assuming it has a decently large chance to absorb neutrons of that energy, like boron-10. The reason that electrostatic force doesn't repel the neutron is because of that it has an effective charge of zero. Simply put, the neutron gets absorbed because it can't be repelled, and we can use this to get rid of neutrons and either slow or stop the reaction. The final but most important subject is xenon poisoning. Xenon-135 is a byproduct of fission, just like strontium, helium, copper, iodine, potassium, lead, bismuth, and so on. The thing that sets xenon-135 apart from the rest, though, is that it really likes to absorb neutrons even when we don't want it to. Normally, xenon is removed while the reactor is on by either decaying away into some other atom that doesn't like neutrons as much, or by absorbing any one of the trillions and trillions of neutrons around it, and turning into xenon-136, which also doesn't like neutrons as much. The reason you don't just immediately try to start back up a poison reactor is because xenon poisoning makes the core really hard to predict. Most of the time, this lack of predictability just leads to overheating and damage to the reactor, but in the case of an RBMK, sometimes this can lead to an explosion. If you're running your reactor properly, you'll never need to worry about this. So to summarize, 1. Uranium-235 splits into fast neutrons but fissions with slow neutrons. 2. You slow those neutrons via a moderator, but uranium-238 needs more moderation to turn into something that can fission, so we add graphite to make up for what we're missing. 3. Water serves as a moderator and a coolant. 4. The inclusion of graphite means that we will still make heat even if our water is gone. And 5, running the reactor at low power will let xenon 135 build up, making it extremely difficult and even dangerous to try to restart the reactor. I know this was kind of all over the place, and in the end you'll probably only need 3 of these 5 to actually understand how this works, but it'd still be an excuse to actually talk about this in the first place, so I don't care. Before we finally make the reactor, yes I lied, what are you going to do about it? You should at least know some discrepancies between NTM RBMKs and real RBMKs. The first is that neutrons in real life go everywhere, while in the mod, neutrons only travel in the 4 cardinal directions. The second is that unlike actual RBMKs, NTM RBMKs have separate blocks for boiler columns and fuel columns. And the third is that NTM RBMKs are heavily simplified versions of real RBMKs, and I only taught you the basics of what goes on and briefly explained those concepts. I know it doesn't sound like that, but I could probably spend an entire day just on the topic of fission. Finally, you can start applying what we learned to our reactor designs. Finally, we're actually in the game. Okay, so remembering how our field will split to release neutrons and heat, we can grab a fuel rod. In this case, I'll take a medium-enriched plutonium rod, and I'll place it into this fuel column. Don't worry that it looks like it's doing nothing, I'll talk about that soon. Now we can surround this with 4 boron absorber columns and place covers on them. Now I can actually answer the question of why it doesn't look like it's doing anything. And that's because it actually is doing nothing. Unlike real fuel, NTM only lets certain fuels undergo spontaneous fission, like this radium-beryllium rod. To fix this issue of nothing happening, we can replace one of these absorber columns with another fuel column, and surround it by even more absorber columns. Don't forget the covers, otherwise you'll leak radiation everywhere. Now, once you've placed the covers, you can insert your radium-beryllium rod, and now you'll finally start to see fissions and heat being created. If you actually listened earlier, which I don't blame you if you didn't, you'll probably realize that we're missing something and you'd be right. We're missing a moderator. The reason that this isn't apparent if you compare these two designs side by side is because of this radium-beryllium rod splits into slow neutrons and not fast neutrons, which don't need to be moderated. Is that accurate? I have no clue. I'm not gonna check. I've already checked way too many things by now. To actually see the effect moderation has, you'll need to include another rod that splits into fast neutrons, like this medium-enriched plutonium rod. As you can see, even though we started both designs at the same time, the moderated version reached 1500 degrees first, meaning that it had a higher rate of fissions, meaning more steam, meaning more energy. Moderation lets us make more energy for the same amount of neutrons. If I wanted to make even more heat, I could use these reflectors which reflect back neutrons using the difference of mass in between the neutron and the nuclei of the atoms that make up the reflector. You can basically just think of it as throwing a tennis ball at a wall. Anyways, we have to get rid of this heat somehow, so we use boiler columns. After I fill them with water, they can absorb and carry away the heat as steam. Pay attention to how I'm placing these pipes and steam connectors, because if you do it wrong, water and steam won't flow, and if you start the reactor, it'll overheat and explode. There are 6, technically 5, components I want to talk about. Well, not because I want to, but because if you don't know any of them, you'll be stuck building boring tiny reactors that barely make any energy, then start complaining to Bob for some reason. The structural column is the... yeah, I don't know. It's kind of just a filler block that can either help spread heat or make your RBMK look more circular. The fluid heater works like the boiler column, but lets you use other fluids inside other than water to transfer heat, some of which actually do this job better. The list of currently usable fluids should be on screen. The radiation channel, also called the outgas around the cosmos for some reason, uses neutrons going into it from any of the four cardinal directions to irradiate whatever item is in this left slot and turn it into a new item. I won't cover the recipes because there are 19 and I don't feel like reading them all out. In other words, use NEI, link to the mod in the description. Something that should be noted, which I didn't write on the script, is if the irradiation channel has an item inside, it will not appear invisible to neutrons, meaning a neutron will be blocked by that column. But if there are no items, neutrons will pass through freely. For some designs, if that design doesn't consider this, some of them might explode, but most of them probably won't. The control rods are one of the more interesting columns, in that you can actually do more with them other than placing them down or forgetting about them. Sure, you could control them manually in close by, but it's way nicer to actually use them far away via a console. To connect your entire RVMK to an RVMK console, take an RVMK console linking device, shift right click to the approximate center of your reactor, and then shift right click the console. Now you can select in either individual columns or groups of columns to control using any of these buttons. If you comment asking what these specific buttons do, I will just say lead because the answer is right there. Now onto what control rods here actually do. They act like an observer column, but depending on the number you put right here, column will allow that value inverted percent of flux through. A 0 here means 100% of flux is let through. A 25 means 75 is let through, and a 100 means 0% is let through, basically acting as a normal absorber column. The RBMK storage column is, well, a storage column for fuel rods. You can either place in rods yourself, or use the crane console and connect it exactly like you did with the normal console, and control it with the arrow and enter keys. Lastly, is the console itself, which I've already mentioned a bit. Skipping over this area, which I've already covered, you can scroll through what value you want to be displayed by clicking the left box and setting the console to display the selected columns as I'm doing here. First I select, choose, and then set. Now about the little graph you've probably noticed in the bottom left. That's a flux graph. That's a flux graph, displaying your highest and lowest flux, or amount of neutrons in a specific time frame. This is probably the shortest segment of the video, only covering a few things. The first thing is turbines. Antium currently has 3 turbines, but I'm only going to cover 2 of them because those 2 are the only ones that you can actually reasonably use. The first is the industrial steam turbine, and the second is the Leviathan steam turbine. Just by looking at them, you can probably guess that the Leviathan steam turbine is better, and you'll also be right. It has infinite throughput and a really large buffer for holding steam and energy, but is also much more expensive. While the industrial steam turbine is much cheaper, but also has a limited throughput of 2,048,000 millibuckets per tick. Regardless of which turbine you use, low-pressure steam comes out, and in order for your reactor to be a closed loop, you have to condense it into water. Antium has 4 machines that you can use for this: the steam condenser, auxiliary cooling tower, or the high-power steam condenser, with a limit of 100, 1,000, 10,000, and 1 million millibuckets respectively. Using more pipes to connect it all, we finally have our closed coolant loop. I'll leave you to design with the knowledge this video has given. The link to both mods is in the description as well as the Discord for the mod. For questions, either try the server or just use the comment section.
Love is no guess when you picture your happiness the way that we do. Roses and kiddies and such, is that expecting too much?
Didn't you say it would happen that way, or were you fooling?